Welcome back. Today's topic is closer properties of context-free languages. First, let me introduce what is meant by closer properties. See, if you have a one language, let's assume that language is the context-free language. Okay. So by using closer properties, we can prove its related languages is also a context-free languages. We have some operations. Under operations, we can prove two languages under some operation, the resulting language is also a context-free language. Here I listed context-free languages are closer under union. Then context-free languages are closer under concatenation. Then context-free languages are closer under star closure. Then context-free languages are not closed under intersection. Then context-free languages are not closed under complementation. Okay, so let me prove how it is closed under union, concatenation, star closure, then not closed under intersection and complementation. Okay, first take this one. So there is a language L1 called as context-free language generated by the grammar G1 equals to, you know the definition of the grammar, V comma T comma P comma S. So we are taking L1 generated by the grammar G1. That's why variable V1, T1, P1, S1. Then take one more language, I mean context-free language, L2, generated by the grammar G2 equals to variable 2, V2, comma, T2, comma, P2, comma, S2. We have a new grammar, or else we have a new language. L equals to L1 union L2. So then G equals to G1 union G2. How we write this new grammar G equals to, it has V1 union V2. So I mean variables are all the unions of the language 1 and language 2. Then T1 union T2. So terminals are the unions of the both languages. Then productions is, let's say production I'm introducing is P. So this is also comes under this one thing, we can written it as V. And this is, we can written it as T. Then P, then take the new starting symbol, S. Okay. So as already written, what is V is? So V is V1 union V2. I'm introducing one more non-terminal, S. Okay, this is V. Then what is T is? So T is T1 union T2. Yes, then next, what is the production is? P is P1, I mean productions from the first grammar and its language, union. Productions from the second grammar and its language, union. I'm adding one more production, that is S tends to S1 slash is represents the union operation, S1, S2. So, and hence we can prove that context-free languages are closer under union operation. Yeah. Similarly, next operation is concatenation. So, if you do the concatenation between the two languages, the resulting language is also a context-free language. That is the use of this closer under concatenation. So, how we can written is similar to the above definition. So, L1 is a context-free language, G1 is a grammar generated by this context-free language V1, comma, T1, comma, P1, comma, S1. Then L2 is another context-free language generated by the grammar G2 equals to V2, comma, T2, comma, P2, comma, S2. Okay. Then how we can return the concatenation of the two languages? L equals to L1, L2, meaning that, so G equals to G1 concatenation G2. So how we can return? So new grammar G equals to V comma T comma P comma S. Where what is V? So V equals to V1. I mean variables from the grammar 1 union V2. I mean variables from the grammar 2 union. I'm introducing one more new non-terminal. It is S. Okay, then terminals equals to terminals from the first grammar union terminals from the second grammar. Okay, then productions is P equals to productions from the first grammar union productions from the second grammar union. I'm introducing one more production. What is that production? Is S tends to S1 concatenated S2. Okay, this is how we can prove that two context-free languages are closer under concatenation. Third one is a context-free language is closer under the closer operation. So let's take L1 is a language generated by the grammar G1. Definition equals to V1, comma, T1, comma, P1, comma, S. Then closure of the language can be written as L closure grammar G equals to V comma T comma P comma S, where V equals to variables, then T equals to same terminals, then P equals to I'm introducing one more new production to the existing productions. So P equals to P1 union S tends to S1 S slash epsilon. See how it is prove this. If for example I have S tends to S1 S slash epsilon, what is the first string generated by this? Epsilon. Then S tends to S1 epsilon. So what is the resulting term? Resulting is S1. Then if I replace S again with S1S, so S1S. If I replace S with epsilon, what is it derives? S1S1. See, then if I replace S with S1 again, so S1S1, S1S. If I replace S with epsilon, it derives what? S1, S1, S1. So it derives S1, 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 and so on. 4S1s, 5S1s, and so on. That's why a context-free language is closer under its star closure operation.
The statement is, two context-free languages are not closer under intersection. Okay, so to prove this, take a context-free language L1 equals to A power n plus 1, B power n plus 1, C power n, such that n is greater than or equals to 0. It's the one context-free language. Then take another context-free language CFL, L2 equals to A power n, B power n, C power n plus k, such that n comma k is greater than or equals to c 0. By looking at, we can say this is also a one context-free language. Okay, if you do the intersection between two languages, L1 intersection L2, if you do the intersection between these two grammars, like G1 generated by this one G1, then intersection G2 generated by this one G2, so we can prove that these two languages are closer under intersection. Closer under intersection. Okay. By the grammar construction. But here I am mentioning not closer under. Why I am mentioning not closer under? Let me prove one more definition. Okay. See, if I do the intersection of these two languages, L1 intersection L2, that is equals to A power n plus 1. B power n plus 1, C power n, intersection A power n, B power n, C power n plus k. Okay, that new language is nothing but A power n, B power n, C power n, such that n is greater than or equals to 0. See, by looking at this grammar, you can say this is not the context-free language. It is the context sensitive language. Okay, so by using this statement we can prove that not closer under intersection. Okay, by using grammar construction, we can prove that it is closer under intersection. By using language intersection, we can prove that we can prove that it is not closer under intersection. See, this is the contradiction statement. So based on contradiction, we can prove that two context-free languages are not closer under intersection.
Yeah, fifth one is context-free languages are not closer under complementation. Okay, before proving that, let me tell you, if L is a regular language and its complement is also a regular language, okay, first initially assume that if L1 is a context-free language and its complement is also a context-free language. If L2 is a context-free language and its complement L2 is also a context-free language. Let's assume initially, okay? Then, see, union of two languages, union of two context-free languages, what is that? L1 union L2. L1 union L2. So, based on this, union of two context-free languages is regular. Now, the complementation of two languages union is also a context-free language. Based on that, I am writing L1 complement union. You can write union L2 complement is also a regular language. Let's assume. Okay. If you use the De Morgan's law, L1 complement union L2 complement equals to L1 intersection L2. Okay. See the beauty of this formula. This is the De Morgan's law. Just now we proved that two context-free languages are not closer under intersection. So this is what we proved. L1 intersection L2 is not a context-free language. Based on this, okay, L1 complementation union L2 complementation equals to L1 intersection L2. L1 intersection L2, which is not closer under. Proved by contradiction. Based on this also, we can prove that complementation of two regular languages is not a closure operation. So, not closure under complementation.